Good evening. Last week, the United States of America sent shockwaves around the world as the country pulled out of the United Nations Human Rights Council. They did not just withdraw, but chastised the global body as a cesspool of bias in the process. The UNHRC has heavily influenced the political landscape in post-war Sri Lanka, with several resolutions passed at the body against what is alleged to be practices adopted by the Sri Lankan military in violation of human rights during the final stages of our conflict here. The last two such resolutions, however, were co-sponsored by the US and Sri Lanka in 2015 and 2017. Now, with the US the chief architect and accuser in these resolutions against Sri Lanka leaving the UNHRC, what's next for us? Sri Lanka's wartime foreign minister and now governor of the Eastern Province, Rohitha Bogolagama, is of the view that given the US exodus, the controversial Geneva resolution brought against Sri Lanka in 2015 should be totally and unilaterally renounced. The governor's views were quoted in an article by Shamindra Ferdinando in the newspaper The Island recently. To speak more with the governor of the Eastern Province and the foreign minister then, Rohitha Bogolagama, we have him here with us at Hyde Park. Good evening, sir, and a warm welcome to our studios.
Thank you. Good evening to you.
Well, I'd like to talk a little about this, the views that you expressed last week after the US announcement of their withdrawal. But doesn't the US withdrawal from the UNHRC automatically invalidate the co-sponsored resolutions on Sri Lanka?
In fact, there is one reason why in my press interview I quoted the word that we must unilaterally abrogate this commitment to the UNHCR. We were virtually pressurized into it, and since the new government coming into being, I think the course got totally changed under a lot of pressure that got mounted from the international forum. During the period in which I myself was the foreign minister, we had the mechanism and we had the ability to resist some of these pressures, which are much more larger in size and in scale and in consequences than this UNHCR resolution. But we managed it over a period of time. But the parties that were interested, both state parties and non-state parties, this is the danger part of the whole process. The non-state parties getting into the UN system can greatly influence the judgment that flows through the process. That is, I take it, one reason why the President Trump has gone in to commit so strongly against the UNHCR and virtually calling it what you just termed as a cesspool of bias, and which we ourselves have been witnessing, the way in which they look at issues in Sri Lanka. Right. How the issues were taken out of context in terms of accountability factor. In fact, in 2009, May 23rd, when the joint communique came between the UN Secretary General, and that was Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, and the government of Sri Lanka, I who was a signatory to that. In that, we were very clear in terms of a domestic process. But beyond that, the international community thought it's best that under the new government, pushed the country into a situation of bringing an additional jurisdiction over the existing judicial systems in Sri Lanka. I am happy to note the recent statements given by the Attorney General, or the submissions the Attorney General has made before the Supreme Court, has clearly demonstrated the fact that Sri Lanka's judicature will not get subjugated to international jurisdictions, and our soldiers and ones who have to be given the type of explanations will not be taken out of context and handed over to the foreign judges to rule in terms of their own acts and their conduct during the conflict. So these are things that is absolutely needed for a state party. A country is a state party, absolutely sovereign in terms of its pursuit and in terms of its profile, and also they get elected, the governments come in to be the custodians of a given period or the people's mandate. And here is where an overt act that was tried to be committed by groups like that of the United States led, have now got into a situation where they themselves are withdrawing through the from the process, and not only a mere withdrawal, through condemnation of the very institution to which they thought is the best vehicle to bring Sri Lanka into account. So I think I'm quite happy of the departure of US, and it's time that Sri Lanka looks at similar measures in line with what Sri Lanka has to do in terms of protecting human rights. It's one thing that we have to keep in mind, but in terms of getting subjugated to so-called non-teeth binders is something that I take it as absurd.
Right, and I'd also like to ask you whether the departure of the US, with it being a heavyweight, weakened the resolve of other nations such as the UK in their agenda against Sri Lanka. Will this probably create that kind of development at the UNHRC?
So I think the very pillars of the UNHCR lies in the major players being part of it.
Right.
Now, you on one hand, US was a major figure, and they always at a given time commanded at least 100 so-called votes in the international fora from the countries behind them. At any given time, US can command that. Now, the EU is another important factor. Mm-hmm. Then comes the Asian grouping. Mm-hmm. But the moment the US is out, where will the EU stand in terms of their own commitment and their own pursuit? Mm-hmm. So I think it has completely weakened. I think this is something that the government spokesperson, Dr. Rajesh Senarath himself has said. I think we have to take it as the view of the government of Sri Lanka. He has gone on saying that the US, I'm quoting Dr. Rajesh Senarath, the government spokesperson, US quitting UNHRC could be advantageous to Sri Lanka. That is the fact that a major player being out, that means what is left in that organization. I look at the three pillars on which the UNHCR stands, US, EU, and the Asian bloc, of which US is already out, and I don't think the Asian bloc is so much committed in terms of the UNHCR process, and thereby EU might have a weaker stand now to articulate what they think is best in terms of their agenda.
Could we also just think about this as the most opportune time for Sri Lanka to possibly make a definitive stand once and for all at the UNHRC? What are your thoughts?
Obviously, I think countries must take their stand. They can't delay because it's an irresponsibility and a default by the people of the country, because in the event you fail to take a stand, that means it will go in terms of default, and thereby you will not have another opportunity to raise these issues. So I think it's time and it's opportune that Sri Lanka takes a definitive stand. I take that should become the view of the government of Sri Lanka getting expressed across the globe, and thereby the world will come to respect Sri Lanka's standpoint in terms of their own commitments in terms of human rights, but against any sort of biased organizations trying to drive you on a purposeless pursuit.
Governor, I think as a former foreign minister, if we evaluate the foreign policy of the country and the diplomatic advancements we've made, I think the government now says that they have achieved major diplomatic advancements. But what are your thoughts as a foreign minister who was holding the position at a crucial time of Sri Lanka's modern history?
So I think credit must go to His Excellency the President Maithripala Sirisena. Singly, he has been able to build up certain amount of understandings at a bilateral level in the international community. He has been well respected as a president that has emerged in the post-conflict scenario, and also elected by the people after a lapse of about 5-6 years of the war ending. Now, this is a good time that the president emerges as the country's leader, and he has tried his best in terms of bringing about bilateral relationships to a high level, which is important. And I take it that's a strong strong aspect in terms of diplomatic relationships, the respect that a leader can command from the co-leaders in the world, from amongst your colleagues in the world, from your counterparts in the world. To that extent, president is right, which he has been always claiming, that the world has changed in terms of a better understanding of Sri Lanka. As a former foreign minister, I endorse that direction that the president has pursued. Having said that, it's important that the diplomatic community representing Sri Lanka and also the ones who are articulating our foreign relations stand up in terms of the challenges we have to now have to face, and also bring about a greater light in terms of what we mean to the world. Now, this is the time that we have to really articulate what we stand for. Now, we have spoken in terms of what we stood in the past in terms of defeating terrorism. That was a subject that I was able to handle at that time. Now, in the post-conflict scenario, the reconciliation factor, the development agenda, the economic advancement are our major concerns and requirements for which the foreign the managers of our country should now articulate where Sri Lanka stands in terms of getting that support generated amongst the international community. We have got major compartments like the Indian factor. Then we have got the U.S.
On that note, Minister Bogolagama, I'm sorry to cut short your observations, but I think we'll have to go in for a short commercial break. To stay with us, we'll talk more of Sri Lanka's ties globally, international relations, diplomatic advancements, and challenges that Sri Lanka faces in economic development. Well, apart from holding the portfolio of foreign affairs, then Minister Rohitha Bogolagama held the cabinet ministerial positions of Enterprise Development and Investment Promotion, and also covered Advanced Technology and National Enterprise Development and the Ministry of Industries. Governor, I think your focus has been investment generation during your ministerial positions then and now as the Governor of the Eastern Province. But if we talk about what you mentioned earlier about national economy, development of the national economy, where do we stand now and what challenges do you observe?
In fact, the time I go back to the time I was chairman of the Board of Investment of Sri Lanka, just after the period of President Premadasa and under President Vijayathunga. At that time, Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe too was the Prime Minister of this country. Now we have come 24 years. So the time I was Minister in charge of investments is 12 years since that period. And today, being the governor of the Eastern Province, I can still mention with responsibility that a lot of projects that were planned dating back to 10, 15 years have still not taken off ground. This is a very unfortunate situation in this country. When we planned the Kappalthure industrial zone development in the east in Trincomalee, it still remains Kappalthure, just a barren land, just abutting the Trincomalee port, which is the second largest hub in the whole world. Now, why is it happened? And then the issue is, since the time we were generating on a daily basis investments flow to the country, and at the height of the conflict that we were also experiencing, still there was a flow of investments directly. And that was coming from the direct FDI. Today, when we take the accumulated investment value, they are coming large in terms of bilateral country-to-country relationships, like that of the Hambantota port, where the state has committed its lease to the Hambantota port with a Chinese company, and that direct investment is flowing. Okay, one may say that's a direct foreign direct investment. But on the other hand, how many similar investments are coming in terms of generation of employment, economic activity, exports in this country? We still find the export growth is negligible in this country because the exports have not grown since the time I myself was minister in charge of exports in 2006 to now. It's not an incremental growth, is not sufficient and not substantial. We are still around less than 17 billion to 15 billion US dollars annual export volume, when in fact we should have been in 2007, 2006, it was still at 11 billion US dollars, 12 billion US dollars. So the time lost against the time that we have been in. So we have to now have a jump start. We need a jump start in terms of our enterprise development in this country. What are the sectors we should develop? What are the production centers that we should really switch on to? What is the type of employment generation that we must target through our enterprise development apparatus? So these are things I think the government should think fast. And this is something that I'm sure, led by President Maithripala Sirisena and with the government in Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe, that combination can strike the type of day-to-day investment drive in this country. There are so many sectors.
If we talk about the SME sector itself, I think you were quite instrumental in setting up the SME bank then, and then the National Enterprise Development Authority. But how successful have we been many years down the line now in terms of promoting, enhancing the efforts and encouraging these industries?
In fact, when the SME bank was planned under President Chandrika Kumarthunga, under which government I served as an enterprise development minister, and then I started it off called the National SME Bank of Sri Lanka. Now with that, I changed the name into Lanka Putra. But from the SME sector, it moved into giving loans to a few businessmen, and who defaulted so badly after my time in charge of that subject matter, it went into big scale loaning, and ultimately non-performance rate went up in that bank to about 40%. So some of these governments or the administrations won't think in terms of long-term objectives for which these institutions have been created for. There's a short-term gain. When Mihin Lanka gets a loan from the SME bank of this country, that is appalling to find how a bank like meant for the SME sector, giving a loan to a major experiment like that of an airline being created. So this is how the purpose for which some of these institutions get created gets killed by the very authors who go in to make these things happen. So I think that's something that the government should learn from our past mistakes. So the important factor is, now I find there's a major emphasis on the enterprise development. I'm very happy to note that that interest getting generated from that of the Honorable Prime Minister's office, to that from the Finance Ministry, then Honorable Rishad Badruddin's ministry. They're all coming together in terms of generating this enterprise development need in this country. I think that is the key. A lot of countries, like if you take Singapore's development, lies in the SME development. You take the Indian economy, lies largely in terms of the SME sector development. You take, for instance, the European development. It's the SME development, the ones who start in terms of being small entrepreneurs, becoming large or creating large enterprises gradually. It's a gradual growth. So I think the government should encourage to develop the SME sector. Two inputs should come in. One is the seed capital. Second is the technological transfer. When these two come, the management can be organized. Then the entrepreneurship can start even at the village level. There are nothing new in terms of entrepreneurship in this country. Sri Lanka has seen the entrepreneurship in the hands of the people. It is now the governments have gone to regulate it too much, but too little policy making has been done to support this. So I think the government has realized that. We are looking for the results of that at this moment.
But when we talk about SME development, I think you're very passionate about how much of effort we need to put as a country. But do you think the framework, institutional framework of the country and policies are directed in such a way that we will support SME development and regulate their requirements?
I think what is needed is to facilitate rather than regulate the requirements. So in the event people are there in the policymaking section, as much as the bureaucracy is there to support the SME, the entrepreneur, which is the most difficult part to get properly organized, because entrepreneurship comes within one's skill, one's interest, one's development needs, etc., the challenges one is ready to pay. So a bureaucracy can't come and, you know, retard that process. You have to encourage that process. And the policymakers should be there in order to encourage lower rate of credit being given, I mean in terms of interest, facilitate in terms of technological transfer, assist them in terms of land requirements, set up their local industrial or service sector institutions. From a barber shop to a tailor shop, entrepreneurship can be created. That's how it must be generated. How many entrepreneurs are there? If you go to a small location in Singapore, and that is the type of feeler that we must create even in Sri Lanka. You come, you start, you develop, you make your money, and you save, you pay your taxes. Then it's a very disciplined society that we can create out of the entrepreneurship. And that is where I think the National Enterprise Development Authority under Minister Rishad Badruddin is now endeavouring to recognize that need, the spirit through which an entrepreneur can be created and developed. Creation is already there in one's, I think, profile when it's an entrepreneur. But the promotion is something that the institutions can promote and help out. And towards that, I take it the incubator system that has to come in, that is like a preschool training for an entrepreneur who gets into testing his skills, the understanding the through the process through which he can generate his industry, etc., can be brought in. So I think these are very valid, important factors. Not too late. In the 21st century, we are just starting off. At least now, it's time that we really concentrate on these schemes for at least without any change on consistent policy framework for a 10-year period. Then we can really offset even the unemployment issues that the country is now facing.
We've been discussing with the governor of the Eastern Province, Rohitha Bogolagama, about current trends of the economy and present-day development. But he has always been an advocate for economic development in Sri Lanka while building linkages to emerging global trends. Well, Sri Lanka needs more foreign and domestic investments to the former war-torn Eastern Province, where there are opportunities in tourism industry and agriculture. But what measures do you think, Minister Bogolagama, we have made so far in order to achieve these developments, and what is actually the Eastern Province's true potential?
In fact, the Sri Lanka's largest province that comprises 1/6 of Sri Lanka's landmass is the Eastern Province. Mm-hmm. It has 440 kilometers of coastal line, the longest in Sri Lanka, and I would say the best scenic location in the whole of Sri Lanka. The population is 1.6 million, but we also claim that we are self-sufficient in our food requirement, largely, and also we are also exporting a lot of excess out of the province. Now, if it comes to our statistics in terms of what we produce in the Eastern Province, we produce 24% of the country's total rice requirement. We produce 21% of the country's total fisheries requirement, and also the export added. We also produce around 120 million liters of milk from the province, from about 450,000 cattle stock. And also we have got other products coming in terms of agriculture products, surpassing most of the provinces in this country. So that's why I term, in terms of the quality of life for the Eastern Province, I think it's blessed with a very scenic location, amongst others, also the tranquility of the location. Now, what is challenging us? Because 30 years it was under a war threat, and also the conflict affected the gradual or the area development, though it also helped in to some extent to keep the virgin lands untouched so that the development can be now planned better. But having said that, we need an advanced development in terms of the economy. Where is this development required? We have the world's second largest port located in the Eastern Province, the Trincomalee Port. The first entry to Sri Lanka throughout history dating back to Tapasvalluka period, the time Lord Buddha lived, is Thiriyaya, Chaitya that was created, was 2,570 years ago. They entered through Trincomalee into the location in Thiriyaya, near Pulmude. Now, with that history, the time the Chinese came, the Portuguese, the Dutch, the British, all got located in Trincomalee, in the eastern part. The oldest schools in the country, dating back to 202, 204 years, are located in Batticaloa. Why? Because the missionaries too came from the eastern part of Sri Lanka, much before Colombo advanced in terms of what it is today. But the 30 years during the recent history, the war affected the required development that we could have expected for the eastern part to get into a better level of economic advancement. Now, today the plan of the government, and my being the governor there, and there is an executive governorship there because there is no council at the moment awaiting elections, so that what we are trying to advance there is the investment drive for the people, both in the agriculture sector, in the industrial sector, and in the tourism sector. Now, when we have got 2.5 million tourists coming into the country, at least I need to see 10% of them visit Sri Lanka, visit the East. but which is not so at the moment. We have only about 140,000 visiting.
Why do you think that shortfall is?
The blame is in terms of communications, in terms of logistics, in terms of travel time. You take Pasikuda, you take Trincomalee, some of the other locations. But what they say is, okay, it takes 7 hours, 6 hours. Yes, that's true. But now we have to augment advanced systems of transport. We can't wait new airports to come. Either we have to have a proper coach systems working from the airport directly connecting with the hotels in the Eastern Promise, which is not bad, like the Greyhound systems in the US. Yeah. Like in Europe, you have got the coach services running right across Europe, running into thousands of kilometers. These only 240 kilometers or 220 kilometers from the Katnaki airport. So proper coach services for tourists to travel within 3-4 hours can be easily done. And then that is where I'm looking for investors to come in to develop or augment and also complement the transport facilitation. We also have started linking the airports like Batiklo from the Katnayaka, because now Batiklo has become a commercial airport. Right. Minister Imal Siripala De Silva has declared that to be one. So we can allow commercial flights to land there. Now we want bigger aircraft, like 50-seaters, 70-seaters, 100-seaters. There are some inquiries getting generated in there. Moment that happens, the travel time is not an issue. The travel time otherwise is an issue. No one likes to travel by jet for 8 hours and travel 7 hours by road. So we want to really help out on that. But having said that, once you get into the location, there's a variety that they can enjoy with the leisure. They can have a lot of other excursions. They can have adventure. They can go in for pilgrimage, likewise. So these are things that I am now trying to focus and develop in the with the assistance from the central government, so that more tourists will start coming.
Right.
And the pilgrim linkages, because we have some famous covils in the Koneswaram is one. Mm-hmm. Then we have got the Mamanga Kovil in Batiklo, the ancient covil that can get linked with a lot of shrines in India. An annual pilgrimage will be getting organized, which we have already started.
Right.
We have got some major events, even Formula One is thinking in terms of the Formula One boat racing.
Mm-hmm.
Now they have done the preliminary surveys. Mm-hmm. If the survey indicators are positive, I understand. So then it's a matter of time, because we have 750 square kilometers of water bodies, inland water bodies in the east, the largest in Sri Lanka.
Mm-hmm.
So with that, the adventure is there, the locations are there, the temperature, the climate is there, and also the land factor is very much in abundance. So we can bring a lot of advanced development to the east. And also now the Prime Minister has initiated the Singapore town plan development in terms of Trincomalee town to make it a major city in Sri Lanka. Savannah Group of Singapore has done the plan, and that's all completed. We are signing to it. It's a matter of the development stage now beginning in 2018 mid.
Right.
So we are in the process of bringing that organized system through which we can bring in a proper planned development to the city of Trincomalee as well.
As well. And I think the government targets investments of over $2.5 billion this year. Out of that, I think the eastern province is expected to lure more investments. What framework have you put in place in order to, you know, grab some of these investments to the province and secure the development of these cities?
Very vital. In fact, I have already spoken with Minister Mahinda Samarasinghe in terms of the port development. And the port of the SLP has about 5,000 acres just abandoned the Trincomalee Harbour. That land is vital for port-related industries to come up. Already the Prima, which is the largest investment in Sri Lanka, is located in Trincomalee. It's a proven case of its success. Then we have got the Mitsui Cement, the largest cement plant in located in Sri Lanka, is in Trincomalee. We have got the IOC, Indian Oil Company, located in Trincomalee. Now their bunker servicing has hit into large development in terms of supplying bunker to the bypass in traffic, the sea traffic. And with that, we have shown the potential out of Trincomalee Harbour, how much of economic activity that can be generated. Recently, I had the visit of the Korean ambassador to the east. We have had the discussions taking place with the French ambassador. We have also looking at the Indian collaboration in many areas of actual term development. And some of the areas where we have regular visitors come in, they're asking for land, including the local ones, in terms of the coconut-related developments in the eastern province. So I think we have to encourage this process. I'm happy on the, some of the initiatives taken by the center, that is the government of Sri Lanka, towards bringing about an advanced level of development strategy for the eastern province, which I am reciprocating by making the land and the other services available from the province. And we also have a very skilled labor supplies requirement, which we are addressing well, and that is being developed along with the educated level of our education systems. So I think we are building the human resources aspect as well.
I'd like to actually focus a little on the national question. The eastern province per se, what is the sentiment of the people, Governor, in terms of the political developments in the country? Are they immune to it, or are they very much part of the political developments? And what would you say should we target at in terms of constitutional amendments and reforms that we are expecting to rightfully answer the national question, to provide a proper solution to the national question?
I think when it comes to the national question, today we have to measure the progress we have made in terms of our reconciliation drive in the eastern province. Now, we have been always speaking of the national question, and then things from the time of our independence, this had been a matter of discussion. Now, reforms have come in terms of bringing the 13th Amendment that one thought could address the national question sufficiently by bringing about certain autonomous responsibilities being cast for local administration of the provinces. Having said that, since the conflict been over, the reconciliation effort under the present government has registered well, in my opinion. If you take the eastern province, the law and order situation remains the best. The crime rate is the lowest. The level of contentment in the people is greater than in most provinces. We also don't have strikes, we don't have protests, we don't have any other upheavals, social upheavals taking place in the province. We don't have people going missing, complaints coming, etc. in the province. So I think the credit should go to President Maithripala Sirisena to have instilled that type of confidence in the province. That is why even the recent elections have shown a very responsible verdict by the people from the eastern province at the local government level. Having said that, what is needed to measure is in terms of what more are we going to cater to. Now, what is this national question that we have been speaking of? When is this, the expected further constitutional reforms are going to materialize in this country? Having allowed those to take place at the national level as well, at the provincial level, I want to instill a very content, a happy community amongst all communities living in the province. That is the Tamils, the Muslims, the Sinhalese living as one, with greater respect to one another, in harmony and with sharing in the opportunities that the province can offer. I think that is getting better registered in terms of their immediate requirement. When I'm to answer the national question, I'll say, okay, let's look at the immediate requirement. We were under a war situation 30 years, two, three generations suffered. Now the new generation looks for what? What do you want? Education, health, infrastructure, development, opportunities, and advance in terms of your livelihoods, etc. I think that is the aspect that we are looking at as government. I am trying to cater to those objectives. And in the event Sri Lanka is going to measure in terms of the happiness index, I want to see the eastern province, the communities are living at the highest level of the happiness index to measure about.
Right. Also, linking the question to the 13th Amendment and the administrative regions being empowered and the provincials being empowered, what are your thoughts and views on how far we should go?
I take it now this concurrent list is a major drawback, in my opinion, towards administering a province, and also it's a burden on the center as well. When we say education, now we have got 1,130 schools under the province, under the provincial administration. We have got 22,000 teachers under the provincial administration. We have got 346,000 students learning in these schools. in the 1,000-odd schools we have. We spend about 8 billion rupees annually in the salaries for the 22,000 teachers in the province. Mm-hmm. Now, in the meantime, you have also a national system of education, which we term as the national schools. Mm-hmm. So why we run to, and there are 30 national schools, and there are 1,200 provincial schools. Mm-hmm. So why not allow the provincial councils to have their education system under certain guidelines? The systems of education testing, like the national exams, can be here, but at the same time, school administration can be a totally a devolved system to the provinces to administer. So I think it's a vital area that we had to look at without running parallel responsibilities and creating institutional and establishment cost and delay in the execution of one's plan. Mm-hmm. And therefore, I take it that's an area the any reforms in the constitution should look at, and to make I take a devolution more relevant and more practical to in the hands of the people and respect the will of the people. Why did we bring devolution? Not to hold back, devolve. And certain subjects that we have decided to devolve, let us devolve in sufficiently and substantially, and the testing can be done at the local level. Other area is concern is the economic, the income at the provincial level. Why are we only dependent on the government to give us the money to administer the province? We need about 20 billion rupees administration, but let us have a taxation system at the local level whereby they too can generate their own income and manage the economy so that the people will understand you can't wait for a dole out coming from the center. You manage your economy, you have your systems working, accountability factors being brought in, and thereby you enhance the quality of the administration. Even for health, you can't have two now health at the super specialty level. Yes, it's vital. Let the government afford that. But in the peripheral level, total health administration must become within the province because it's a devolved subject again, the health part of it. So likewise, we have an irrigation. Why only small, minor? We have no proper classification, definition sometimes to identify these so-called the demarcations. Mm-hmm. So it unnecessary we load. We run an irrigation department, center runs irrigation department. Maybe that we must classify mega projects. Let it be like the hydro schemes, mm-hmm. etc. Let us have that with the center. But some of the peripheral ones, better administered, better manpower can be mobilized, better quality of service can be offered to the people if it is at the provincial level. The fisheries, some areas are matters that the easily the provinces can administer so that their income can be measured in terms of what they do.
Right.
And here, you are trying to measure the performance of a province, not from what they do, from what they see being done. Mm-hmm. So that is something I totally try to emphasize. A need-based judgment must be brought and reforms must be done in order to enhance the quality of service at the provincial level.
Right. Thank you very much, Governor of the Eastern Province, Mr. Rohitha Bogolagama, for joining us at Hyde Park. And I think we're indeed grateful that you have the time to join us here to share with us your vision and your plans for the Eastern Province and the greater development of the national economy. Have a pleasant evening. We'll see you again next week, same time at Hyde Park.